Welcome back to the sixth video in this series on professional PHP development. In this video, I want to share more about environment variables and how you can set these up in a secure and user-friendly way. In the last video, we set up a container and configured a connection for our repositories, but we didn't actually connect to a database. In this video, I'll quickly add a database to our Docker setup and then show you how to set up credentials for that database. We'll use environment variables and a .env file to retrieve those credentials. Let's start with setting up our database for local development. Keep in mind that the Docker compose file we have here is only meant for local development, and in production we'll have a more secure setup. As we're only using this setup in local environments, we can configure it with some hard-coded credentials, which we can actually commit in our repository. So next to our web and PHP FPM image, we're going to have a DB image, and it's going to be based on MariaDB. And we add a bunch of environment variables here. These are environment variables for the image. And please don't use these in a production environment, but I'm going to use some very unsafe variables here. So I'm going to set this to password. I'm going to use the database, user, and another password. And then we need to expose a port, 3306. And then we're going to bind the volume data var zip as well. And then we also need to edit here as a volume. And that's basically it. So if we now do a Docker close up in daemon mode again, with a typo, then we have a running database. And let's actually test this in our IDE in PHP Storm. We have a database tab here. And if we add a new data source for MariaDB, that is the user, password, and database. And if we test our connection, it actually succeeds. And then we can also look inside the database, and there's nothing here yet. But at least we're able to connect. The last time we set up a var dump of the product repository in the product controller. So let's remove that. And instead, when this product repository gets constructed, we do a var dump of the connection get database, which will actually try to connect. Now you can see we have a could not find driver error. And the reason for this is that in our connection service provider, we specify that we want to use the PDO MySQL driver. But then in our Docker file, we just use a simple PHP 8 FPM image. So let's extend this image. So in our Docker folder, we create a new folder for PHP FPM. I usually make these correspond with the ID of the image. And then I create a Docker file in there. And then we're going to specify that we're extending the image name we just copied. And then we're going to run one command, which is Docker PHP next install of PDO MySQL. And then instead of this image, we need to specify a build parameter, which is Docker VFPM. And then if we run a new Docker compose up in daemon mode, I'm going to build that image. And if we head to our browser, now complaining about no such file or directory, which is correct because we can't connect to the database. And that is because we didn't specify the correct username, password, host, etc. But right now, our credentials are set in the connection service provider. And there's only currently a username here because we don't want a password to end up in our Git repository and in our Git history. So we need to find a way to do this reliably. And as you've already seen before, we can use environment variables. And these are actually the same ones we need in our PHP FPM image. So we could add them here, and we don't need the root password. And then we can do another rebuild of the image. And then we can use these with the getenv function. So if we do getenv, and we do MySQL user, and we can also use it these in our PHP code. But there's one problem, there's multiple problems, because this list is going to get very long, the more environment variables we add. And also, this is only our Docker compose for our local environment. So we want a way to reliably get these environment variables also in production. So let's remove this. And we're going to leave this getenv for now, but we want to replace this with something. And the most common way to do this is with .env files. And because we want to really make sure that these do not end up in our Git repository, we first mark these as git ignored. So now we can safely add the file without it being included in our Git repository. And we're going to add a bunch of settings here. So we have a database name, we have a database user, database password, database host, port, and database driver. But the next person that checks out this repository doesn't know about all these keys. So what we can do to be nice to our teammates is to copy this over to a .env.example file. And we do commit this to Git, but we make sure that our credentials never end up in here, but only are set in our local.env. And the next time a person checks out the repository, they can copy the env.example to a .env file and fill in their credentials there safely. Now let's quickly fill in these parameters. So our database name is database, username is user, password is password, host is going to be database. We didn't set that yet, so let's set our container name here. Our port is 3306 and our driver is PDO MySQL. And let's close everything for now. So we have a clean slate. Now, there are a bunch of packages out there that support loading .env files, and it's also included in most frameworks. But because we are not including any framework and we're doing most of the stuff ourselves, let's also build this because it's not that hard to do. So let's create an environment class. And it will have a method called get. Return a string for now. And then we could use a string key here, but let's make things stricter. So we'll create an environment key enum. And because the names of the key might change in the future, we'll use the backed enum to actually store the value. And then in here, we use this environment key enum. And then we can use the keys from our example file. Let's copy these over to a replace. Of this. And we have all our cases. Let's indent these. And now we have this typed. Now, retrieving the environment variables is not going to be the responsibility of this class because this is just an object. So we're going to pass these through the constructor. And we're going to call this variables. And it's going to be an array of string. So the key is going to be a string and the value is going to be a string for now. And then here we return, need to mark this as a private read-only array. And then we do this variables key value. And if it doesn't exist, we return null. We need to also add this to the return type. Now, to be able to use our environment class in our connection service provider, we need to tell our container how to resolve this environment class. So let's create a service provider for that. So we create a new environment service provider, which implements the service provider interface. We provide the environment class. And then our resolved set add read of the identifier and static function. So we want to return a new environment class here with our variables. And let's start with an empty array here. And we want to load our env file. So we have our env contents. Well, contents of two directories up. Slash.env. And then we want to iterate over all the lines in there. We do an explode of slash r and slash n on env contents as env line. And then we get the key and the value from another explode on the equal sign env line. Maximum of 2, because if there's more than 2 or more than 1 equal sign on the line, the second is part of the value. And then we set the variable by the key, the value. So that's our environment service provider done. So let's add this to the kernel. So we have an environment service provider class string here. And then in our connection service provider, we request the environment from the container. And then we use this get the environment key database user. And let's do a var dump here for variables, because I think this might be wrong. And it is. So we need to do a UL explode here. And if you see, we have one empty item here at the end, and that's because our env file ends in a new line. So we'll also need to skip any empty lines. So if our trim of our environment line equals an empty string, we just skip this. And now this looks better. It's finally time to use all the environment variables. So we're going to add a bunch of here. So it's a, we have a database password, database host, database port, and database driver. So this is the password, host, port, driver. We also need a database name. Called DB name. We'll have our var dump in here. And then in our controller, we don't do anything. So let's make sure we exit in here. And then we see we're actually connected to our database. So after this video, we have an environment class we can inject into any service provider closure to connect using environment variables in .env files. As you might have noticed, the env file parsing only handles best case scenarios. What if, for example, the file doesn't exist? I'm not going to handle that in this video, as this is already getting quite long. Make sure to subscribe, and I'll hopefully see you in the next video.